Welcome to the weekend series entitled Global Call to Prayer. We're so glad that you joined us. Do you know this prayer conference was designed with you in mind? And we are glad to be able to join with you in these unprecedented times in which we're living. I'm Pastor Peter Neary, the senior pastor of Paradise Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this is Karen Martell, who's the prayer conference coordinator for the Pacific Union Conference, and
a pastor's wife.
She's a pastor's wife, and she did a lot of the work for this whole program. So we're so glad that you have joined us. And notice at the bottom of your screen, there's a teleconference telephone number that you can call and share your prayer requests. We'd love to pray with you and to pray for you. And Karen, you've got some important details for us.
I do. You know, this program is great. It's going to be a tremendous blessing to you. It's going to be a tremendous blessing to you because we're living in troubled times,
we
Peter.
Are. Mm-hmm.
LLBN-TV and the Pacific Union Conference have partnered together to present this exciting program. And God wants each of our viewers, as well as you and me, to experience
yes.
hope, healing, and peace. This is only one in a series of five powerful presentations that will radically change your lives.
Yeah.
That will radically change your lives. We have been earnestly praying, and we're confident God will do what he needs to do. Parts of this, because of COVID, have been pre-recorded sessions. And we know that you'll enjoy those, too. They're very special, and we have done them just for you.
And don't forget, at the bottom of your screen is the prayer conference call. Please call us in so we can include you in this conference.
We want you to listen closely as Pastor Randy Maxwell shares a message, a call to be born. Grab a pencil, a paper, and your Bible, and I know that you will be blessed.
Amen.
The day of the Lord is coming. That day, the day that all the prophets, they have been announcing. Are we ready? Are we people ready for that day? He will come. He's inviting us to prepare our hearts for that encounter. Now, says the Lord, turn to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, with mourning. So when your heart, not your garments, return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful. Slow to anger and of great kindness. And he relents from doing harm. Who knows if he will turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering or a drink offering for the Lord your God? Blow the trumpet in Zion. Consecrate a fast. Call a sacred assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders. Gather the children and the nursing babes. Let the bridegroom go out from his chamber, and the bride from her dressing room. Let the priest, who minister to the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not give your heritage to reproach, that the nation should rule over them. Why? Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? No, do not let this people question our loving God.
Wherever you may be tonight, may we lift up this prayer together. May we be able to experience His power in our lives as we invite the Holy Spirit into our lives. Join us. This is
Can we say amen? Let's bow our heads together. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. You are welcome in this place. You are welcome in our hearts. And it is you that we have come to celebrate tonight. It's you that we respond to in this global call to prayer. You have summoned us, Lord, and we are here. You are the star of this program. You take center stage because you have a message for us tonight. And we pray, Lord, that our hearts are receptive, our minds are open, and we're prepared to receive and to act on, Lord, what it is you have called us together tonight to hear. Please, Father, move me out of the way. It is not important that anyone hears my voice. What's important is that your voice is heard. So take control of this place and this hour and use it to extend the kingdom and to magnify your name, and we'll be quick to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Let all the people say, amen. Amen. Welcome. We have been summoned. The shofar has sounded. Sounded the signal for assembly. And we have assembled, but for what have we assembled? It's an odd assembly, to say the least. Thanks to COVID, this is not your usual prayer gathering at a comfortable lodge or at a campsite where we'd be able to pray and sing and eat and worship together in smaller, intimate groups like we've done for the past 20 or 30 years. But maybe that's the point. The times call for something different. Something more urgent, a summons, a global sacred assembly brought to life through the prayers and leadership and vision of the Pacific Union Conference prayer team in partnership with Loma Linda Broadcasting Network and Good News TV. Groups have been praying earnestly in the early morning hours for this particular assembly for months. But why? What is the meaning of this call to prayer? Now, in this virtual format. Well, you don't need me to tell you that 2020 is very different from 1990 or 2000. 2020 can be summed up by a popular meme that's circulating on the internet right now, or on Twitter, of a flying cow seen through the windshield of an anonymous driver. And the caption on the meme writes, "What the? Never mind. I forgot it's 2020. In other words, that which would be considered bizarre, unexplainable, even weird, under normal circumstances is par for the course in this very weird, bizarre, and unpredictable year that is anything but normal. And the word you hear on blast over and over again to describe all the weirdness of the pandemic and the protests and the violence and the fires and the political polarization, the storms, and don't forget the murder hornets. The word that you hear over and over again is unprecedented. But if there was a word being blasted over and over again on the internet, on social media, and in the streets to describe the church, God's people, during this unprecedented time of weirdness and upset, what would that word be? Now, for obvious reasons, you might blurt out prayer. But for most of you watching, this isn't your first rodeo. As I alluded a moment ago, some of us have been attending and planning, speaking at, prayer conferences for 30 plus years. And over those three decades, we have met and prayed through some very unprecedented times. For instance, the 9/11 terror attacks, the Great Recession of 2008, Hurricanes Katrina, Sandy, Rita, the Pope's address to a joint session of Congress, the second Gulf War, the Indonesian tsunami, the Las Vegas, Parkland, Virginia Tech, Emmanuel Baptist Church mass shootings. And spiritual breakthroughs may have occurred elsewhere, but right here in North America, with few exceptions, our prayers have fallen short of producing the revival of true godliness that we've been told is our most urgent need. Back in the fall of 2015, I was a passenger in the seat of a retired pastor in Idaho as we were driving to eastern Idaho, Pocatello area, to conduct some ministry training classes. And he was going to conduct a training session for elders on how to preach. I was teaching on the subject of prayer. And as we were driving, he asked me this question. He said, "So, Randy, after all the years of prayer conferences and prayer retreats, prayer lines and prayer chains, why haven't we seen revival yet?" And you could imagine that that was an uncomfortable question to have thrown at me. It stung. I knew what he meant. And I can't really remember exactly how I answered his question. I'm sure I came up with something, but I think we would have to admit that while the idea and the results of revival appeal to us, the means of revival often do not. We would like an app for that. Revival delivered to your door, free shipping at a time convenient for you. It's like the poem by Wilbur Ries, $3 worth of God. I would like to buy $3 worth of God, please. Not enough to explode my soul or disturb my sleep, but just enough to equal a cup of warm milk or a snooze in the sunshine. I don't want enough of him to make me love a black man or pick beets with a migrant. I want ecstasy, not transformation. I want the warmth of the womb, not a new birth. I want about a pound of the eternal in a paper sack. I'd like to buy $3 worth of God, please. But in 2020, the days of discounting God are over. We've been summoned. And we've been summoned here tonight to value God properly, to give him the glory due his name, and to repent of trying to have Pentecost without Calvary. And maybe the other part of the answer, the other reason for repentance, is trying to have revival without the Redeemer. Maybe in our pursuit of the fruit, we have neglected the vine. John 15, verse 5 says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing." Well, fruit is an outcome of a relationship. Pursuing revival without a relationship with the Redeemer is like marrying somebody for their money. You see, you love their wealth and the material comforts and lifestyle that that wealth provides, but the marriage is simply an arrangement. It's a means to an end. Jesus says, "If you abide in me, remain connected to me in a living, intimate relationship, the fruit of revival will naturally come. But apart from this connection to me, you can do nothing." Is it possible then that in our pursuit of revival, we have left Jesus outside knocking and seeking entrance into his own church? I believe in this moment, we've been summoned to let Jesus in. God is calling us to our first love, to go back to the basics of our faith and discover again why we are Christians in the first place. Or if indeed we are Christians. You see, this is a moment for you and for me to do as the Apostle Paul says, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you? Unless, of course, you fail the test. 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. But I like the way the Amplified version says it. The Amplified says it this way, examine and test and evaluate your own selves to see whether you are holding to your faith and showing the proper fruits of it. Test and prove yourselves, not Christ. Do you not yourselves realize and know thoroughly by an ever-increasing experience that Jesus Christ is in you, unless you are counterfeits, disapproved on trial and rejected? According to Paul, there is a time of testing and examining. And what is being tested is us. If you think that the COVID crisis and racial injustice and the economic and political crisis is solely a judgment and testing time on the world that is rejecting Christ, you'd be mistaken. You see, I believe that these current crises are equally a time of judgment and testing on the church. The church that claims to represent and follow Christ. After all, who is Paul talking to when he says, examine yourselves to see whether you're in the faith? Is he saying that to the world? Well, they're not in the faith. It's those who allegedly have Jesus Christ inside them, unless they are counterfeits, which can only be revealed under testing. And we see such testing brought by God on the children of Israel following the deliverance at the Red Sea. God may have taken his people out of Egypt, but he's now got to take the Egypt out of them. And the desert was his testing room. 3 days beyond the Red Sea, they reached Marah. Marah, the water was bitter there. It was foul. Now remember who it was that led them to Marah, to bitterness. It wasn't Moses. It was God. The cloud took them to Marah. And why did God take them there? Exodus chapter 15, verse 25 says, there he tested them. And Deuteronomy 8, verse 2 reveals the nature of the test. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you, in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. God led them there to see what was in their hearts, and nothing reveals what's really in the heart more than life's bitter trials. And how did they do on the test? They grumbled against Moses, saying, "What are we to drink?" They failed the test. They failed it miserably. They're like the boy who went to his college professor and said, "Professor, I don't believe I deserve this F you gave me." And the professor said, "Son, I don't believe you deserve it either, but it's the lowest grade we had." You see, a person's true character is not totally revealed until the time that they do not receive what they sincerely believe is rightfully theirs. Let me say that again. A person's true character is not totally revealed until the time they don't receive what they believe is rightfully theirs. Now, do you think you would have responded differently at Marah? The world right now, 2020, has been brought to a Marah moment. And what's in the hearts of many are being revealed. What's in your heart at this Marah moment? If Facebook and Twitter are any indication, then what's in the heart in even God's people is shameful. It's Mara. I was reading a blog the other day by Carrie Neowulf, and the blog was entitled, Why Attending Church No Longer Makes Sense. Now, in that blog, the author made a case for the death of churches where attendance is prized over engagement. In other words, people who just come to sit and consume. And he was making a case that in this COVID era, those kinds of churches are passing off the scene. Now, the blog generated more than 200 comments. I decided to read some of them. And as I scrolled through them, I decided myself that one of the reasons fewer people are attending church is because of Christians like these making comments like the ones I was reading. It was brutal. Just a week ago, a very close pastoral colleague, friend of mine, and we pray regularly together, told me of an incident that happened Sabbath morning as he showed up to a church. He's an evangelist. He showed up to the church to baptize his younger brother and his wife. And this is at the end of a revival series of meetings where he had been baptizing regularly, every week, every weekend. He was meeting and greeting people in the lobby, and then he received a tap on the shoulder. And there was a gentleman there, a member of the church, who invited him to step outside, wanted to share something with him. As he invited him to step outside, he began to lambast my friend, raked him over the coals, and then brought up something very painful. About 2 years ago, my friend's cousin was gunned down in a police incident. He was killed. And this person who was castigating my friend knew about that incident and told him, this is a as a Seventh-day Adventist brother, told him moments before he's to step into the baptism tank, your cousin deserved what he got. And how was he supposed to take that? And this is just moments before he gets in the baptistry. But this is a brother who had some personal axe to grind. You see, some believers believe that if they themselves have been hurt, or if someone disagrees with them ideologically, theologically, even politically, someone disagrees with them, that gives them a pass. It gives them a pass to lash out with cutting words and scathing rebukes, but the Bible gives no such pass. The word says, be angry and sin not. It also says, in Ephesians chapter 4:31, get rid of all bitterness. Get rid of all Mara, rage and anger. Today's default setting on attitudes outside and even inside the church today is rage. And prayer, no matter how sincere, cannot survive in that toxic atmosphere. God brought the children of Israel to that place of bitterness on purpose. This test was part of God's plan to train them under comparably easy circumstances for the experiences that they would later face in Canaan. And we're reminded in Great Controversy, page 622, the time of trouble, such as never was, is soon to open upon us, and we shall need an experience which we do not now possess, and which many are too indolent to obtain. Now, if we can't trust God now, when things are comparatively easy, how about later? I mean, think about it. We're losing our minds and our religion over masks. No one has put us in jail. No one has padlocked our churches. We're not being forced at gunpoint to burn our Bibles. And over masks, we're losing our minds. Jeremiah 12, verse 5 says it this way: if you have raced with men on foot and they have worn you out, how can you compete with horses? If you stumble in safe country, how will you manage in the thickets by the Jordan? God's purpose in bringing his people to Marah and testing them in the wilderness is the same for us as it is, as it was for them, to prepare his people to be his bride and to live with him forever. But the bride of Christ must have the mind and the heart of Christ before the wedding. And obtaining these requires nothing less than a rebirth. Jesus said to Nicodemus, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Have you been born again? Have I? You see, this was the simple and often offensive question that helped spark the Shantung Revival in northern China from 1927 to 1937. The revival was birthed in a time of military conflict, social instability, and lukewarmness in the church. The condition of the northern China mission run by the Baptists was in disarray. Many of the missionaries had resigned. Evangelists made discouraging reports of the work among cold, apathetic, even dead churches. In the North China mission, at least 70 churches are reported to have died. Many had accepted God's grace as an outside coating of whitewash, but it only covered their sins, not received forgiveness. A discouraged Chinese evangelist reported that more than 1,000 people had been converted to Christianity, but not to Christ. Into this scene of despair came a small Norwegian evangelical Lutheran woman named Marie Monson. A small, diminutive woman, very quiet in her demeanor, but yet she had a penetrating, probing way of delivering her testimony and preaching. She visited mission statements and churches, giving her testimony and speaking on the seriousness of sin. How sin can be an impediment, a blocker to revival. There was no sensationalism in these meetings, it was reported. One missionary wrote, Miss Monson herself is one of the quietest speakers I've ever heard. There was very poor singing, not like the beautiful singing we just had. There was very poor singing and no invitation for public decisions. What kind of meetings were these? But after each service, she greeted the Chinese and the missionaries alike with one probing question. Have you been born again? Now, the question insulted some, and it angered others. But she was relentless. She spared no one. She asked the question of preachers, of deacons, of missionaries, and evangelists, all the same question. And they would take offense. What do you mean if I've been born again? I'm an evangelist. I'm a missionary teacher. I'm a pastor of a church. But once their anger subsided, the Holy Spirit began to search hearts, and many discovered upon closer examination that they had not been born again. She went place to place asking the same question, and people would go home and they would kneel down beside their beds at night and they would cry out to God, God, am I a counterfeit? Am I born again? Is there sin in my life that needs to be removed? And then they would pray and they would weep, and sometimes into the wee hours of the morning, they would wrestle with God until the breakthrough came, and God would give them release. He would give them joy. He would give them peace in the Holy Ghost. And one by one, revival meetings began springing up, not only in the churches, but also in the schools, in the hospitals, and in the seminaries. Students in one school began confessing their sins, so much so that the school was closed to allow the revival free reign. Services were held every day, morning and evening, and by the end of 10 days, 600 girls and 900 boys had made confession to Christ and were saved. Miracles occurred, healings, and eventually the estimate was that there was at least one Christian in each of the 1,000 homes in the town. The revival started with a simple question of self-examination. But at first people took offense. They didn't see the reason for the question. They were missionaries after all. They were suffering from a condition, and I'm not going to say it right, so if there's medical people here or in the audience, okay, don't write me, okay? It's called anosognosia. I'll spell it for you. A-N-O-S-O-G-N-O-S-I-A. It's also called lack of insight. It is a symptom of a severe mental illness that is connected to anatomical damage in the part of the brain involved with self-reflection. This impairs a person's ability to understand and perceive his or her illness. It's the single largest reason why some people who are troubled with schizophrenia or bipolar disorder refuse medications or do not seek treatment. Because without awareness of the illness and refusing treatment, it appears rational, no matter how clear the need for treatment might be to others. And I think tonight Laodicea must suffer from the same illness. Because Laodicea lacks self-awareness. Lack self-awareness of their condition, thinking that they are rich and increased with goods, having need of nothing, not aware that they are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Their lack of awareness is why Jesus is on the outside trying to get in. My friends, at this critical hour, we must pray continually to be born again, to receive new minds and hearts, and let Jesus in. Why does revival tarry? Perhaps we need to start with a very simple question. Have we been born again? Is Jesus the object, the supreme object of our affection? Because it seems as if other things are occupying the space in our hearts that he should have. And whether it's political party, whether it's country, whether it's our own ideas about some of the social unrest in our streets, it seems as if these things have become godlike to us. And our movements, our speech, our attitudes are shaped by those things and not by the Word of God. I can't find any justification for some of the things taking place under the banner of Christianity. And let's go all the way back. Let's look at Jesus' day. Because there was in Jesus' day a very sophisticated religious establishment who knew the law of Moses, the Torah, backwards and forwards. They knew the prophecies. They could recite them. And into that very controlled religious environment where everybody had certain status comes an itinerant preacher named Jesus of Nazareth, Galilee. Can anything good come from Nazareth? And Jesus started upsetting the social order. He started eating with sinners, publicans. He started offering hope in the kingdom of God to those who generally were kept on the outskirts, on the outside of polite society in Jesus' day. And they didn't like what he was doing. And so guess what? They adopted a philosophy of the end justifies the means. Better for one man to die than for the whole nation to perish. And so, strange bedfellows, they partner with Rome. They partner with Rome to do away with Jesus. Church and state came together to accomplish a common end, to put down an uprising that, who knows, could spill over into the Roman government and upset the order, the calm that they were supposed to provide in the streets, and to get rid of this troublesome Jew who was turning over tables in the temple and eating with the wrong people and drawing crowds and attention to himself. Church and state came together to accomplish a common end. Doesn't it make you wonder, in 2020, as we see church and state coming together to accomplish what? Is this something that we were told about in Scripture? Is this something that we were told would happen in the book of Revelation? You see, we're afraid here in America of a lot of isms. It could be Mohammedism. It could be New Ageism. It could be feminism. Atheism. A lot of isms have us upset. But have we forgot? Have we forgotten that the prophecy warns not about any of those isms? But it does warn about apostate Protestantism. Have we forgot that? What are we doing? Who has our affections? Do we love Jesus? Do we even know Jesus? Is there a reason why the parable of the 10 virgins, the 5 foolish, the person at the banquet says, depart from me, I never knew you. How could that be? Lord, Lord, didn't we cast out demons in your name? Didn't we do mighty miracles in your name? How can you say you don't know us? And I think Jesus will say, because you didn't have my heart. You gave yourself a pass. You gave yourself a pass when you were upset or when your toes got stepped on, and you didn't love your fellow man, you didn't love your brother as I have loved you. You had the charts, right? You had the 27. You had the diet. You had the Sabbath. You didn't have me. You didn't have my heart. How's that possible? Apparently it is, because the letter to the first church of Ephesus says, I have this, you're great, your theology is on point, but this I have against you, you've lost your first love. Why does revival tarry? Our prayer, and there's been lots of calls to prayer, our prayer tonight, as you go to your rest, have you been born again? Does God have your heart? When Jesus comes again, will he find faith on the earth, in the church, in you? So we've been summoned, but to do what? To have our hearts examined and to pray one of the most dangerous prayers we could pray. From Psalms 139, verses 22 and 23. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties and see if there's any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Or how about this prayer from Psalms 80, verses 18 and 19? Revive us and we will call on your name. Restore us, O Lord God Almighty, and make your face shine upon us that we may be saved. Or how about this one from Joel chapter 2, verses 12 to 13, the calling of the shofar. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. My friends, I want to make an appeal to you tonight. I don't know how much time we have left. 2020 has been a wild ride, and it's not over yet. We have no guarantee that 2021 is going to be any different or any better. I believe Jesus is going to come. And if you're worried about the election in a few weeks from now, let me remind you of something, regardless of your political affiliation. Please go back to Daniel chapter 2 and remind yourself of the dream of Nebuchadnezzar. And please remind yourself of how that dream ends with a stone that is cut out without hands that smashes the image on the feet and becomes a huge mountain that fills the whole earth. And remind yourself that that stone is Jesus coming again, establishing his kingdom. And if you and I are born again, if our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, if we are walking with Jesus as our Lord and Savior, my friends, our citizenship is in heaven. And believe me, it is secure. Jesus, God, is still on the throne. And there's nothing to worry about what happens on planet Earth, the affairs of men. God is in control of it all. And he's working out his plan. As uncomfortable as it may be, we were warned, we were told about times of trouble. But Jesus said, be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. But if you're going to be of good cheer tonight, you've got to be born again. So I want you to bow your heads. I want you to pray with me. Father in heaven, we come humble. We come humble before you, Lord. We have nothing in our hands to bring. Simply to thy cross we cling. We confess tonight, I confess, Lord, that too often I have tried to get by with $3 worth of you. And I have wanted Pentecost without Calvary. I've wanted ecstasy, not transformation. And that's why revival has tarried. We've wanted the results. We've wanted the fruit. But Lord, too often we have ignored the vine. And tonight, your call is for us to come home and to love you with all of our hearts. Would you do a work, Lord? Would you do a work of repentance and renewal in my heart tonight? Would you do that for my friends who are watching this online, for all of us who have responded to the shofar call? Please, dear God, cleanse our hearts and renew a right spirit within us. Help us to let go of the idols and the things that we have put in place of you, and embrace you again as our Lord and our Savior. remind us of why we're Christians, of what it is to be a Christian, of what it is to live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Forgive us for where we have twisted it and gotten it wrong. We love you, Lord. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's my prayer, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have an invitation tonight. Jesus invites each of us to be born again, to be renewed. Thank you so much, Pastor, for that invitation. And we all take it to heart tonight, wherever we are. We know it's not easy always. Sometimes it's easier to stay where we are safe, to stay where we are, what's familiar. But as we sing this response, brothers and sisters, wherever you may be, our prayer is that you may be reminded once again of the joy that there is when we trust fully in Jesus, to trust in the calling he has given us as we're living in such a time like this. May we learn to trust him and to surrender all that we are so that we can experience that revival that we so need. Yes. May this be a prayer of our heart, church family.
Oh, cuán dulce es fiar en Cristo y entregarle todo a Él, esperar en sus promesas y en sus sendas serle fiel. Cristo, Cristo, cuánto te amo, tu poder probaste en mí. Cristo, Cristo, puro y santo, siempre quiero fiar en ti.
'Tis so sweet
to trust in Jesus.
So sweet to trust in Jesus.
Just to take him at his word. Just to rest upon his promise. Just to
our prayer, Father God, yes, that we may be able to trust you more and more every day. May you be blessed, church.
Well, Pastor Randy, we want to thank you for that wonderful challenge. It went right to my heart, brother. I mean that. God is good.
God is good. And even as I sat here listening to you, my heart was moved. And Pastor Randy, I want to be reborn.
I do too.
I want to just totally and completely surrender my life and my heart to Christ. And I want to do it right now.
Amen.
I want to do it right now. And those of you in our audience who are feeling this way, do it right now. Don't wait. Don't wait. Jesus is coming again. Father God, we just want to say thank you for loving us, for this promise of salvation, for this promise of help, Lord, if we confess our sins to you and are born again. We thank you for that blood of Jesus. In his precious name, amen.
And I too want to thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts tonight, for letting us know that each one is important to you. And that call to be born again goes to even the worst sinners. For to you all sin is bad, Lord. And yet your invitation is free and open to all. And we respond, yes, Lord. And we pray that those who have joined us tonight would say yes to you too, that we can be born again, born from above, broken on the rock Christ Jesus, and glorify your wonderful holy name. In Jesus' name, amen.